morning as we gather together on the first day of Lent, our great God. A few announcements before we actually begin our worship service this morning. Special salutes go out this week. Happy birthday to Kristen Cook today. Jennifer Hibbs on the 27th. Deb Rossi on March 1st. Chantel White and Jeff Paz on the 3rd. And happy anniversary to Carl and Sarah Gibson on March 2nd. The church calendars for the month of March are on the back table. Our Sunday morning pastries will be suspended as of today. However, we will continue the coffee on Sunday morning through the month of March. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of March, and it will be our covered dish luncheon after our morning worship service. Our Wednesday evening Bible study continues this week with the study of Matthew chapter 20, and Rob Espinoza will be finishing up that this week. There will be a elders, deacons, and preachers meeting at the building here at 1 o'clock. So if you are one of those, plan on being here. We'll be planning, scheduling events and church growth for this year. In our prayers, Dick Jones is in Fairview Lantern, Suite 504. Mary Stottlemyer is in the Gillette Nursing Home in room 607. Chris Cassidy is in the Cleveland Clinic, and we have many, many more on our sick list. You can see those names there. Any other announcements before we begin our worship service this morning? Father, we thank you so much for the blessings that we have and the relationship that we have with you, for your grace and your mercy. We thank you that your Son, Jesus, was willing to leave his place of glory in heaven with you and become a willing sacrifice on our behalf, that through his sacrifice we have been freed from the bondage of sin and we are reunited with you spiritually. When you created man, put him in the garden. As we come together this morning, we pray to your Heavenly Father that you would hear our worship service this morning. May the things that are said and done be in harmony with thy will and pleasing to you. I pray to your Heavenly Father that you would be with our elders and deacons and preachers as they meet this afternoon. I pray that you will guide them, that they will be able to lead your church here in Cortland in this year, that we would be spiritually uplifted, that we can put programs into effect that glorify thy name and help us to grow stronger together. I ask that you would be with the ones on our sick list, the ones who have been mentioned this morning, and all those who are suffering with physical difficulties in their lives. I just pray that it would be your will that you would touch them and heal them. We pray also, dear Heavenly Father, for the ones who are spiritually sick. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that we would be able to reach out to them, that we would be able to influence them, that they would realize the state that they're in, that they would come back into the fold, into the church once more. We thank you so much again for your blessings. We thank you for the church that was established through my Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. This morning we're going to start off with a little melody of three songs. It'll be 273, 275, and 276. We'll be standing up there. And the first one will be More Precious Than Silver.
More precious than silver, though you are more
Song Before the Prayer, number 745. Humble yourself.
Thank you.
sung for the Lord's Supper and canopy. I don't recall singing this one for quite a while. Maybe we have a D-Lent scene. He has to think about it.
Yes, but not this arrangement of the older version of it.
Okay. So we're going old school. See how it goes. And can it be that I
thank you. Let's pray. Father, at this time, get back part of the blessings you give us. Let's remember how much we're blessed. And never forget, again, the sacrifices that you made, allow us to think about those things as we sacrifice to give back a portion of what you have blessed and given us. It's your son's name we pray. Amen.
So for the offering song, we're going to try a song in a round. That makes me nervous. So you guys are going to start with me. And Randy, you're in charge of when you guys come in here. You know where you're going. I've got faith that you can do good. Brian, you guys are all over this. It is written a little...
This doesn't hold the same one as in the book. Well, which one do you have in the book?
You guys, this is a good question. Do you know the song from like camp and that kind of stuff? Okay. So, you go, Father, I adore you. And the next part will be, this happened. And you'll repeat that kind of thing. It is written a little bit off, but it's the best one I can find to you.
Within the sacred page, I 1 through 4. But now, Job, listen to my words. Pay attention to everything I say. I am about to open my mouth. My words are on the tip of my tongue. My words come from an upright heart. My lips sincerely speak what I know. The Spirit of God has made me. The breath of the Almighty gives me life.
Thank you, Josh. Josh's brother, Dylan, is going to be giving autographs after church today. He was honored to be a part of the honor guard at Arlington Cemetery. Dylan, now let's see. You didn't like fall asleep during the honor guard thing, did you? That was quite, I told him he'll never forget it. They have pictures galore. So see Mom and Dad and Dylan and probably Libby's Facebook page. And how many of you have seen the changing of the guard in Arlington at the Tomb of the Unknown? It's quite impressive, isn't it? I have a gift that was given to me this morning by one young family towards camp, a very generous gift to help out the camp. And I'm just so impressed on a number of things. First of all, young families, you have so many things that you could use your tax refund for, and to see somebody give a substantial, every gift counts, but this very generous gift. And that encourages me to know that the future is alive and well. And I'm also, I'm not going to say about things about it every week, but I'm very thankful that we have been able to, I don't want to say stumble on the Camp Blue Rock, because I don't want to rule out God's providence in helping us to find that place. It was on our list of search places years ago when we had to leave Judson. But this time around, it really seemed to be ideal for us. And things just seemed to be really working well. One of the weaknesses to it was that we weren't going to have any place to put our lady cooks. We don't care about Sean and Randy. They can put up a pup tent and they'll be happy. But you can't really imagine Michelle and Debbie climbing in a pup tent, can you, after a long day's work? So anyway, we were able to go online to a thing called RV Share, and you tell them where you want to be, and they bring up all kind of people that own RVs that are very interested in renting them to responsible renters. And so we have found one close by, a brand spanking new one, and it says it sleeps 10, but that's like the two in the queen bed. But I think it will sleep 6 or 7 very comfortably. So ladies, this Tuesday, I'm supposed to actually nail down the deal with the gentleman, and he gave us a special price to accommodate us and seemed to be real eager to help out. So you ladies, you're gonna have a good place to spend the week. Open your Bibles, please, to Job chapter 32. Now, you girls that are going to last to leaders, I quizzed you last week, and again, just repetition, 7 major characters in the story of Job. First of all, obviously, God. Also, an adversary in the form of Satan. And then there's Job himself. And then there are 3 so-called friends that come to comfort Job, but their words end up being not so much helpful as harmful. And their names are Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. And then there is another character named Elihu. We'll talk about him today. Jeannie said to me, how come you don't count Job's wife? she's in the story early on. And she is in the story, but she kind of doesn't really warrant to be one of the big seven because of her bad behavior. And Job says in chapter 2 and verse 9 and 10, you know, after he loses so much, he and she lose so much, and then he's smoked by boils from head to toe, she says to him, do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die. Well, that's not the kind of exhortation you're hoping to get from a faithful wife. But Job said to her, you speak like a foolish woman speaks. Indeed, shall we accept good from God and not accept adversity? Well, I don't know how to judge Job's wife. We could be tough on her, but maybe in fairness to her circumstance, I have watched over the years of my ministry, sometimes the people that are ministering or serving to a wife helping a sick husband or vice versa, sometimes it's harder on the person who's actually the servant of the sick one than it is on the sick person. Burdette's experiences of the last couple years, if the truth is known, it's probably been harder on Charlene than it has been on Burdette. And part of that has to do with sometimes you feel helpless. You do all you can, but you wish you could eradicate it all and make it all go away, and you can't. And you just do the best you can, but sometimes it hurts a whole lot to be. So let's give Job's wife a little bit of slack there. But this morning I want to introduce us to Elihu. His name means, my God is He. Sometimes I like to use Jeannie as a kind of a testing ground for sermon material. And I think back, I was blessed to be raised in the church, but she was blessed to be raised in the church, and her dad was a preacher. And so sometimes I might say, and I didn't this week, but I was going to ask Jeannie, it slipped my mind, tell me everything you know about Elihu, or what do you know about Elihu? So I'll ask you that this morning, all of you together, since I didn't get to quiz Jeannie. What do you know about Elihu? If I said, take out an index card and tell me everything you know about him, and some of you are looking at me like, Elihu? Elihu, what do you know about this man? Well, let me try to enlighten us a little bit this morning. We alluded to him last Sunday, just briefly so, but this morning I want to speak a little bit more fully about him. And we might be inclined to think in the flow of things in the book of Job that he's just another counselor in a line of counselors, friends, comforters. Eliphaz comes in as Job's friends, as Job's friend. He's followed by Bildad, and then Zophar, and then all of a sudden Elihu comes on the picture. That's sometimes what we're inclined to think. Well, he's just a fourth counselor. He's just a fourth friend who's posing as a counselor. But there's something about Elihu that sets him apart from the other three. So I've asked you to turn in your Bibles to chapter 32 and through 37, and we'll get into the text in just a moment. There's a bit of a mystery about Elihu. At this juncture, Job's three friends seem to have exhausted their counseling sessions. And likewise, we might say for Job, because as you remember, this has been dialogue. From chapters 4 through 31, one friend, Eliphaz, comes in and counsels Job, tells him what he thinks, and then Job responds. And then Bildad comes in and tells Job what he thinks about Job's problem and why Job's suffering. And then Job gives him feedback. Zophar the same. And this goes on for three rounds. And finally, both the three friends and Job are exhausted at talking. Chapter 31 closes with an editorial note. See if it says that in your Bible. The words of Job are ended. That's what mine says. And as we move into chapter 32, I don't think we realize it, at least not right away, and I'm not even sure we realize it even after we've gotten through multiple chapters here, but it, certainly as we start in chapter 32, the entrance of Eli signals a turning event for Job. Now, that can sneak up on you as you begin reading it. You may not even notice it. But maybe just think about it this way. How tragically sad it would have been if the book of Job would have ended at chapter 31. And that maybe hints a little bit at the important role that Elihu plays in the rest of the story of Job. Job chapter 32 and verse 1 begins this way. Elihu speaks, and he says, "These three men," meaning Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, "these three men ceased answering Job." Actually, this is not Eliphaz speaking, this is just a statement. "The three friends stopped answering Job because he appeared to be righteous in his own eyes." He was self-righteous. They're exhausted because he doesn't seem to be listening to them. Verse 2 states, "But the anger of Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite of the family of Ram, burned." So let me shorten it here by just saying, "The anger of Elihu burned." Remember, this is a different day and age, and sometimes men were not only given names, first and last, but they were associated with their place of origin. Like in chapter 4 and verse 1, Eliphaz is a Temanite. And then in chapter 8 and verse 1, Bildad was a Shuhite. And chapter 11 and verse 1, Zophar was a Naamathite. And Elihu, I like his name best, he was a Buzite. The book of Job opens, if you remember, by noting that Job lived in the land of Uz, U-Z, chapter 1 and verse 1. But if you look at a passage way back in Genesis chapter 22 and verse 21, we find that Uz and Buz were two brothers that lived around the same time as Abraham. And so this allows us to rightly conclude that Elihu was fully human. He's got a family tree. He's not untraceable. We know his background. So just like Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, Elihu is a human being. And I'm emphasizing here that he's fully human. But as we'll see this morning, Elihu seems to be light years ahead of his other friends in his own counseling skills. Elihu had apparently been present when all of this dialogue was taking place between Job's three friends and Job. We would never know that in reading chapters 4 through 31. We're not told that there were other people listening in, or that this is some kind of a public arena kind of a dialogue taking place. But as we begin this section, chapter 34 and verse 4, Elihu reaches the point now where he can't be silent any longer. And he says, if you look at chapter 34 and verse 4, Elihu had waited to speak because they were years older than him. In other words, he's saying, Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar were older, and what right did he, as a younger man, have to say anything in the presence of his elders? So he had a healthy respect for his elders. He knew what was common in those days to show respect for your elders. So he just remained silent. He's listening to it all, but then finally, something is burning within him. We've all had this feeling. You just, you get to the point where you can't be silent any longer. And chapter 34 and verse 4 continues by saying, when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouth of the three men, the three friends of Job, his anger burned. And he spoke out and said, I am young in years, and you are old. Therefore, I should be shy and afraid to tell you what I think. Or therefore, I was shy and afraid to speak up. I thought that age should speak and that increased years should teach wisdom. And then Elihu adds words that sound bold or even brash and brazen. He says in chapter 32, verses 8 through 10, it is a spirit in man, and the breath of the Almighty gives them understanding. The abundance in years may not be wise. Just because you're 90 doesn't mean you're wise. Nor may elders understand justice. Just because you're an older one doesn't mean you've got it all figured out. So Elihu says, listen to me, I too will tell you what I think. Now, if you've been reading, as we've urged you to do throughout the book of Job, you might recollect many chapters ago that there was a longing that was expressed by Job earlier. If you can look back to chapter 9 and look at verses 33 and 32, and this is when Job is in a pit of despair. He doesn't know, his friends are talking to him, he knows they're not telling the truth. And he doesn't know where to turn or what to do. And he says, God is not a man that I'm able to answer him, that we could go to court together and figure this thing out. I could plead my case and he would tell me his side of it. And so he says there is no umpire between us. I'm having trouble with God, but I can't go to him and talk to him about it. And there's nobody that can go between us, that can help us, me figure out this problem. That's my translation from the New American Standard. There is no umpire between us. I went and looked at a few other renditions. The New Century Version says, Job says, I wish there was someone who could make peace between us, between me and God. We've got a problem, and I need an umpire. I need somebody that can make peace between us. Or the today's English version, which is a paraphrase, there is no one to step between us. And I like the New English Bible. It says, Job says, if only there was one to arbitrate between us. The idea here is that Job is yearning for an arbitrator, for an advocate, for a go-between, an umpire, or the word that we all know when we come to the New Testament is, we need a mediator. We need somebody to stand between us and God. And it's my contention, now on your little note card about everything you know about Elihu, this may be new to you, it's my contention that Elihu is God's answer to Job's prayer. Job is praying, saying, I wish I prayed. If there was just somebody that could be a go-between between me and God. And it almost seems here in chapter 34 that Elihu appears upon the scene out of nowhere. Nobody saw him coming. I certainly didn't. We've got to know Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar for good or bad. And then all of a sudden, here comes Elihu. And we don't know anything about him. Where did he come from? And he tells us, I've been listening all along to you. And he's not real happy with what he's been hearing, but he just appears out of nowhere. And my argument here is not that Elihu was an angel. Sometimes we see that in the Old Testament. An angel appears out of nowhere and helps somebody. I'm not arguing that he's an angel or some kind of a heavenly messenger sent by God, but I am arguing that he is simply but significantly a man with a heavenly message. Bear with me on this. As I said earlier, Elihu is fully human, but he is unlike the others. He's younger, as we noted. They're elders. He doesn't qualify as an elder. He's a younger man. How much younger, we don't know. And we notice as we compare the statements from Elihu to Job that there's much more compassion in the words that he has to say to Job than when we listen to the words from Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar. They're kind of harsh. And sometimes they're mean-spirited. They're really tackling Job in a not-so-nice way. In the end of the story of Job, if you go ahead all the way to chapter 42, and we've been there previously, and you can go there again this morning and look at verse 7. In the end of the story, God expresses displeasure. God is not happy with these three friends. And so he rebukes Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar. He reprimands them, and his reprimand is quite specific. He says to them, you have not spoken of me what is right. And then he tells them, therefore, take seven bulls and seven rams, and listen to what he says. You three friends, you three counselors of Job, you go to my servant Job and offer a burnt offering for yourselves, and my servant Job will pray for you. And then he says, for I will accept him so that I may not do for you according to your folly, because you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has. Hold on to that thought. In a couple weeks, we'll talk more about that. Now, did you notice in chapter 42, verse 7, there's a rebuke of three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. Some commentators and Bible scholars just gloss over this point. The point I want to make here is there's no rebuke of Elihu. In my studies, I found a lot of people want to say he's just another friend, like the first three that comes in. But there's no rebuke for Elihu, and you could say, well, God must not have. He must not have got the memo that he was trying to help. Well, God knows all. So if Elihu needed to be rebuked, God would have rebuked him. And let me hold that thought for just a minute. So what I'm saying, we might be inclined, I'm not, but some are inclined to include Elihu as just another misguided, somewhat arrogant counselor like the first three. What I'm suggesting here is that Elihu, that his words are God-given words. I know that's a pretty strong claim. What I mean by God-given words, that they are God-breathed words. Given to him by inspiration. It's not that Elihu by himself, who is a son from Buzz, it's not just that this son from Buzz is light years ahead of his other three friends, but it's that God gave him the words to say. Did anybody catch that I said kind of Buzz Lightyear? Kind of weave that in there, thinking I would get a chuckle. I wasn't sure if somebody gave me a chuckle back there. Jeannie asked the other day, she said, what is it about you and Larry Wheeler that you guys are so corny? She said, was there something in the water that y'all drank and asked you to go? I don't know what it is. I like, she didn't say it quite that way, but that was the gist of what she was saying. Larry was on a bus tour the other day, and he was memoing friends, and he was at the Cleveland Botanical Garden, and he said, here I am, planted at the botanical, which I thought was pretty funny. But Jeannie took that, and she said, what is it about you and Larry? I don't know. I can't explain it, but every once in a while, I'm going to go corny. And I expect that you will give me a little chuckle once in a while just to keep me going. All right, so it's not that Elihu is just light years ahead of these others. It's that God is helping him. God is answering Job's prayer. I wish I had an arbitrator. I long for a mediator, a go-between. Out of nowhere, here appears Elihu. And I'm not going to just speculate on that. Let's go back and read chapter 32 and verse 8. Some of the first words from Elihu are this. And you have to maybe read this from different translations. And it's open to interpretation. But he says in verse 8, it is a spirit in man. Now, if he just said that, I wouldn't think of capitalizing spirit or saying it's the spirit of God in man. But he adds the phrase, he says, it is a spirit in man and the breath of the Almighty that gives him understanding. Elihu is saying something pretty significant here. He's saying that God has given me understanding to help you. And then he adds, or I could say that the fact that God doesn't condemn Elihu's message like he did the other three, that is what someone has said is a tacit endorsement. Now it is, the word tacit means kind of silent and maybe assumed. In other words, in chapter 42, God doesn't say, okay, Bildad, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, you three really messed up. But Elihu, I like what you said. There's no mention of Elihu. But the fact that God doesn't condemn him is silent endorsement of Elihu. And Elihu makes a similar claim in chapter 33 and verse 34. He says, my words are from the uprightness of my heart, and my lips speak knowledge sincerely. Now, that doesn't mean a whole lot at this point. But then he says, the Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty gives me life. That's what animates me. That's why I'm here, because God has spoken to me to speak to you. In chapter 33 and verses 31 through 33, Elihu speaks candidly and rather authoritatively, especially for a young man. He says, pay attention, O Job. Listen to me. Keep silent and let me speak. And then he adds, therefore, if you have anything to say, answer me. If not, listen to me. Keep silent, and I will teach you wisdom. That verse there directed my mind to two New Testament passages You remember when Jesus came off the mountain, the Sermon on the Mount? And the text says that Jesus was teaching them as one having authority, and not like just one of the scribes. This is almost exactly what's happening here. Elihu, unlike the three wise men, he is teaching authoritatively to Job. And in the other New Testament, that's from Matthew chapter 7 and verse 29, but it also reminded me of James chapter 1 and verse 5, where it says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, and God gives to all men generously, and that wisdom will be given to him. This is exactly what Job was asking for. He wanted somebody that could step in between and help him make sense of his problems. What's also quite noteworthy about Elihu's somewhat lengthy monologue, it goes from chapters 32 through 37, is that when he gets done talking, Job says nothing. Now, you may say, well, what does that mean? Well, if you're a parent, a lot of times it's like the dialogue we meet earlier on with Job and his three friends. One friend says this, and then Job bristles and he talks back. Parent gets his child aside and says, I want to tell you what you've been doing here, and I want you to listen close. And then he says something, and the kid, very seldom does the kid just sit there and say, when mom or dad are done, the child will start and say, well, let me tell you my side of the story now. But this time when Elihu gets done, Job does not retort. Unlike the dialogue with the other three, he has no argument for the words of Elihu. And actually, the absence of a retaliatory strike on the part of Job or a retort is indicative that he's making a pretty favorable response to the words of Elihu. And Job's silence there, his silent response to Elihu, blossoms even more, because when God finally speaks in chapter 40, earlier than 40, but when God speaks, Job says in chapter 40 and verse 4, what can I reply to thee? And he says, I lay my hand on my mouth. I'm going to button my lip. In multiple ways, Elihu is a go-between. Like in chapter 9 and verse 32, this time just before Elihu arrives, Job says something very similar in Job chapter 31 and 35. He says, oh, that I had someone who could hear me. And then he adds, behold, here is my signature. Let the Almighty answer me and the indictment which my adversary has written. In other words, I'm ready to go to court. I've got my document signed, sealed, and delivered. If there was just somebody who would listen to me. And then here comes Elihu. In chapter 38, God speaks to Job. I know you can't wait till we get there and hear that message. And we'll get there pretty soon, or you can go ahead and read ahead. I wonder if we take Elihu out of the picture, if we were just to go from chapter 31 to the beginning of chapter 38, had God broken onto the scene immediately after Job's friends stopped talking, that transition from those three clown counselors to the Almighty God, I think that would have been too great for Job. It very likely would have been too much to bear. So Elihu bridges the gap, not only from a literary point of view, but think about it in your mind, between these three friends who are hurling at Job false accusations, they're offering vain or empty solutions to Job's problems, but wedged in between that and then God's last word is Elihu. So Elihu's role as a mediator, it is borne out in the textually in the book of Job, but doesn't it make perfect sense of what we know to be the nature of our wonderful God, that he is a God who is compassionate and long-suffering and loving? So enter this Elihu picture, not a messenger, not God himself, but a messenger sent from God. In just a moment, we're going to pray. In closing, I hope that this lesson has not only been informative. If you looked at me like a deer in headlights when I said, who is Elihu? I hope that you'll now know a little bit more about this very important character, Elihu. So I hope it's been informative, but I hope it's also been encouraging. And we're going to hear more from Elihu, not next Sunday because I'll be out of town, but the week after that we'll pick up. And I want to say here, because some of you are wondering, Job is not without fault. Job has committed transgressions. They're not the many slanderous falsehoods that are leveled against him or charged against him by his friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. I have to think about their names every time I say it, Hannah, but I'm doing it for your benefit so that you'll hear their names over and over again. And for you, Riley, as well, and Gabby, for you. So if I ask you again who are the three friends, you're going to have heard it about 10 times today. So I'm going to ask you on the way out, so be ready to tell me. You're going to have an exiting exam, okay? That just goes for you three little ones. I won't make you older folks go through that. We're going to hear more about Elihu, but Job, he's got transgressions, which is a fancy word for sins. They're not the sins fabricated by his three friends, but they are serious transgressions nonetheless. Elihu is going to have some strong words to say to Job, words that will help bring about his restoration. In Job chapter 32 and verse 3, we noted that Elihu, when he first comes on the scene, it tells us that his anger turned against Job's three friends. But in Job chapter 32 and verse 2, it also tells us Elihu's anger burned against Job. In our next sermon, we'll focus on Elihu's rebuke of Job. His words are strong. He pulls no punches. But as we'll see, and I mentioned this earlier, he speaks the truth in love. His words seem to be baptized in compassion. He's not ruthless and harsh with Job. And I feel confident that we can rest assured that Elihu's words spoken to Job are wisdom from above. Your assignment between now and March the 12th is to read Job 32 through 37. What is that, six chapters? Yeah. Six chapters. Read these six chapters with your notebook, and you try to synthesize or summarize what is it that Elihu is trying to tell Job and Job's problem is. What's Job's problem? Read and reread, even if you've read them already, go back now and read them and say, okay, this is Elihu. He's not just one of these three windbags. This guy seems to know what he's talking about. God seems to be guiding him. What is Elihu telling Job? What is Job's problem, and how is he going to correct it? Would you bow in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, thank you for hearing Job's prayer, for sending Elihu to him to speak the truth in love. Thank you for hearing our prayers as you do, and thank you for sending faithful messengers to help us along on our way as well. Thank you for the love and patience you continue to display, especially when we are hurting very badly and maybe not responding to that hurt as we should be. And especially when we experience a blind spot in our perception of your never failing presence. Help us, Lord, when we think that you don't see us, and that you don't care, and that you don't hear our prayers. Help us to trust that you do. Through Christ, our beloved go-between, we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for your good attention. This has been a really good series, I think, for all of us, and it's going to speak to us even more as we bring it to a close over the next month or so. If this morning you are ready to give your life to the Lord, if you're not a Christian and you want to become one, we would be honored to help you to be baptized in Christ, confess your faith and sins, commit your life to Him. For the many of us who have already done that and are Christians, let's sing heartily as we talk about gratitude to God. And also, I think our last song is kind of a prayer to God. Would you stand, please, and join in as we lead you?
Thank you, Lord, for loving me, and thank you, Lord, for blessing me. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole and saving my soul.
Every hour I need thee, oh, what God the Father, as we sang that song, we need you every hour. We thank you that you're calm, that you are there every hour. And that our Lord Jesus Christ will never leave us alone or forsake us. Father, may we forever be grateful to you for all that you have done and continue to do for each one of us. We pray one for another. In Christ's name, amen.